Harper Audio presents All Involved, a novel by Ryan Gattis. Performed by Anthony Ray Perez, Jim Cooper, James Chen, Marisol Ramirez, and Adam Lazarre-White.
The facts. At 3:15 p.m. on April 29, 1992, a jury acquitted Los Angeles Police Department officers Theodore Brezeno and Timothy Wind, as well as Sergeant Stacy Kuhn, of excessive force used to subdue civilian Rodney King. The jury failed to reach a verdict on the same charge against Officer Lawrence Powell. At roughly 5 o'clock p.m., riots began. They lasted 6 days, finally ending on Monday, May 4, after 10,904 arrests had been made, over 2,383 people had been injured, 11,113 fires had burned, and more than $1 billion worth of property damage was sustained. In addition, 60 deaths were attributed to rioting, but this number fails to account for murder victims who died outside active rioting sites during those 6 days of curfews and little to no emergency assistance. As LAPD Chief Daryl Gates himself said on the first night, quote, "There are going to be situations where people are going to be without assistance. That's just the facts of life. There are not enough of us to be everywhere." End quote. It is possible, and even likely, that a number of victims not designated as riot-related were actually the targets of a sinister combination of opportunity and circumstance. As it happened, nearly 121 hours of lawlessness in a city of nearly 3.6 million people contained within a county of 9.15 million was a long time for scores to be settled. This is about some of them. Day 1. Wednesday. An even more interesting question is, why is everybody worrying about another riot? Haven't things in Watts improved any since the last one? A lot of white folks are wondering. Unhappily, the answer is no. The neighborhood may be seething with social workers, data collectors, VISTA volunteers, and other assorted members of the humanitarian establishment, all of whose intentions are the purest in the world. But somehow nothing much has changed. There are still the poor, the defeated, the criminal, the desperate, all hanging in there with what must seem a terrible vitality. Thomas Pynchon, New York Times, June 12, 1966.
Ernesto Vera, April 29, 1992, 8:14 p.m. 1. I'm in Linwood, South Central, somewhere off Atlantic and Hollanda, putting tinfoil over trays of uneaten beans at some little kid's birthday party, when I get told to go home early and probably not come back to work tomorrow. Maybe not for a week even. My boss is worried what's happening up the 110 will come down here. He doesn't say trouble or riots or nothing. He just says, that thing north of here. But he means where people are burning stuff and breaking out storefronts and getting beat down. I think about arguing because I need the money, but it wouldn't get me anywhere, so I don't waste my breath. I pack the beans away in the truck's fridge, grab my coat, and leave. Earlier in the afternoon when we got there, me and Termite, this guy I work with, saw smoke. 4 black towers going up like burning oil wells in Kuwait. Maybe not that big, but big. The birthday kid's half-drunk father sees us notice them as we were setting up tables, and he said it was because the cops that beat Rodney King aren't going to jail for it. And how did we feel about it? Man, you know we weren't happy. But we didn't tell our boss's client that. Besides, it was a raw deal and all, but what did that have to do with us? It was blowing up somewhere else. Here, we shut up and do our jobs. I've been working the Taco Salunico truck going on 3 years. Whatever you got, I'll sling. Al pastor, asada, no problem. We do some nice cabeza too, if the mood hits you. Otherwise, there's lengua, pollo, whatever. You know, something for everybody. Usually we park over by our stand on Atlantic and Rosecrans. But sometimes we do birthday parties, anniversaries, anything really. We don't get paid by the hour at these, so I'm happy when they're done sooner. I say bye to Termite, tell him not to show next time without washing his hands good, and head out. If I walk fast, it's 20 minutes home. 15 if I take the boardwalk through the houses. It's not a boardwalk like Atlantic City or nothing. It's just a thin little concrete alley between houses that serves as a walkway between the main street and the neighborhood. That's our shortcut. As my sister would say, fool's been running from the cops on it since forever. Go down and it takes you straight to Atlantic. Go up and it leads into the houses, street after street. That's where I go when I get there. Up. Most people's porch lights are off. Backyard lights too. Nobody's out. No familiar sounds. No Art LeBeau oldies music playing. No people fixing cars. When I'm passing houses, I only hear TVs on. And all the anchors are talking about is looting and fire and Rodney King and black people and anger, and that's cool, whatever, because I'm focused on something else. Don't get me wrong. I'm not being cold or nothing like that. I'm just taking care of what I need to take care of. You grew up in the same neighborhood as me? One with a gun store that sells single bullets for 25 cents to anybody with bad thoughts and a quarter? Then you might end up the same way. Not jaded or pissed or anything, just focused. And right now, I'm counting months till I can get out. Two should do it. That's when I'll have the money saved up to get some wheels again. Nothing fancy. Just something that gets me to work and back without having to walk these streets. See, I've been cooking someone else's recipes forever. But I'm not trying to stay that way. When I get my own car, I'm driving to downtown and begging for an apprenticeship in the kitchen at R23. This crazy sushi spot smack in the middle of a district that used to make the majority of toys in the world. But now the warehouses are all empty and the toy stuff is up to China. I heard about it through Termite, because he loves Japanese too. I mean, he loves everything Oriental, especially women, but that's besides the point. He took me up there last week, and I dropped 38 pinche bucks on a meal just for myself, but it was worth it because of what these Japanese chefs did. Stuff I never even dreamed of before. Spinach salad with eel. Tuna seared up so good with a blowtorch that it's cooked on the outside and all buttery and raw in the middle. But what really shook me was this thing called a California roll. Outside, it's rice pressed into these little orange fish eggs. Inside, it's a green circle of seaweed around crab, cucumber, and avocado. It was that last ingredient that messed me up bad. Man, you don't understand. I'll do anything to learn from those chefs. I'll wash dishes. I'll sweep floors, clean bathrooms. I'll stay late every night. I don't care. I just want to be near good Japanese food. Because in the time it took me to order the roll for its name, stare at it, and decide I didn't want it because I'm sick of avocado, only for Termite to call me out, and by then I just had to shrug and take a bite. When it hit my tongue, something sparked inside me. My whole brain just lit up, and I saw possibilities where I'd never seen any before. All because some chefs took something I was so bored with, something I see every day, and turned it into something else. Cut, scoop, and mash enough avocados and you'll know. You'll get an ache in your bones quick, kind that only comes from your hands memorizing movements by doing them over and over till you do it in your dreams sometimes. Make guacamole every day but Sunday for almost 4 years and see if you don't get sick of those slimy green suckers too. Something smacks the fence by my head and I jump back with my hands up and ready. I laugh when I see it's just a fat orange cat because, damn, that got my heart going. I keep moving, though. Lin was no place to be caught standing still, not if you're smart. Downtown's different. It's a better world up there. At least it could be for me. And there's so many things I want to know, so many questions I want to ask those chefs. Like, how does this place affect food anyway? I may not know much, I'm pretty sure they don't have avocados in Japan. Our roots in this city are in Mexican food, because California used to be Mexico. California's even got a little Baja beer that still is Mexico, even though the land north of it is something else now. Like me, kind of. My parents are from Mexico. I was born there and carried to L.A. when I was one. My little sister and brother were born here. Because of them, we're Americans now. This is what my walks home are for, kicking questions around in my head, dreaming, thinking. I get lost in it sometimes. As I'm turning the corner onto my street, I'm back to wondering what the hell the Japanese chef was thinking before inventing the California roll, and my mind's ticking over how even avocado can become something new and beautiful when put in different circumstances. And that's when a car with a grumbling engine comes up behind me. I don't think much of it. Not really. I move to the side, but it brakes next to me. So I move all the way over, right? Like, no problem. He'll just go by when he sees I'm not involved. No cholo uniform, no tattoos, nothing. I'm clean. But the car keeps up with my pace, inching forward. And when the driver's side window rolls down, Motown-style fast piano pours out. Around here, everybody knows KRLA. 11:10 a.m. on the radio dial. People love their oldies around here. The opening bit of Run, Run, Run by the Supremes is going. I recognize the sax and piano. Hey, the driver says to me over the music. You know that homeboy, Little Mosco? The second I hear my little brother's street name in that stranger's mouth, I start booking it back the way I came. With every step, it feels like my stomach's trying to claw its way out of my body. It knows this is some serious fucking trouble. I hear the driver laugh as he throws the car into reverse and slams on the gas. The car passes me easy and barrels to a stop. That's when two guys get out of the front and one jumps out of the bed in the back. Three guys all dressed up in black. My adrenaline's all the way up now. I must be more alert than I ever been in my life, and I know if I make it out of this, I need to remember as much as possible. So I turn my head and look while I'm running and try to memorize everything. It's a Ford, this car, dark blue. I think it's a ranchero. It has a taillight out, left side. I can't make the plate number because I'm turning my head as I take the corner onto the boardwalk, and I'm breaking between houses, trying to bust out onto the next street, hop a fence, and disappear into somebody's yard. But they're on me too fast. All three of them. They haven't worked 10 hours over a grill serving tacos to a bunch of damn kids and drunks. They're not tired. They're strong. I hear them coming up hard behind as blood thumps up in my ears, and I know I'm as good as caught, man. I get one cold second to gulp air and brace myself before they swoop in, kick me off my feet, and smash me in the jaw with something hard as I fall. After that, shit goes black for I don't know how long. I've been hit in the mouth before, but never like that. I come to as they're dragging me back to the car and it feels like my face is going to fall apart in two pieces. Around the ringing in my ears, I hear my boot heel slide grinding over the asphalt and I figure I couldn't have been out for more than a few seconds. Don't do this, I hear myself say the words. It surprises me how calm they are, considering my heart is going a million beats per minute. Please, I didn't do anything to you. I have money, whatever you want. They respond, these three, but not with words. Rough hands jerk me up to my feet, out of the boardwalk and into the back alley with garages on both sides. But they're just setting me up. Quick, weak punches hit me in my kidneys, my stomach, my ribs, too. I get it from all angles. They don't feel hard, but they steal my breath away. At first, I don't understand. But then I see the blood, and I stare at it on my shirt. And as I'm wondering why I didn't feel the stabs, a bat hits me. I see a flash of black a second before it lands and flinch away. The heavy part only gets me in the shoulder, but I go from being upright and looking at my shirt to flat on my back and staring at the night sky. Damn.
Yeah.
One of them screams in my face.
Yeah, motherfucker.
I crumple into a ball, my jaw feeling like somebody's frying it up in a pan. I bring my hands up and protect my face, but it doesn't help. The bat comes down again and again. I catch one in the neck and my whole body goes numb. A different voice says,
tie that shit off while he's flat like that.
I can't hardly breathe. Another voice, maybe it's the first voice, joins in.
Yeah, do it if you're so big, Joker.
One's named Joker. I need to remember that, I think. This is important information. Joker. The word sticks in my brain and I turn it over. I don't know any Jokers except for comic books, and it doesn't make any kind of sense why they're after me and not my brother if he did some stupid shit again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.